welcome to the Hungry Eye stage, epic recording star, whose friends prefer to call him just plain God, Godfrey Cambridge.
Thank you for that very warm greeting, folks. I'd like to welcome you to the Eye, and also tell you that we're taping this show tonight for my mother. Sarah X. She's the critic for Muhammad Speaks. You notice how fast I ran up here? That's because I'm trying to change our image, you see. I know that's a heck of an introduction, you know. People always get shook up when I come on, they say, oh my goodness, he was introduced as God, you know. Say, is that what he really looks like? Oh. They go home and overpay the maid, you know. Kind of wild. Well, I get very carried away biblically anyway, you know, like a lot of times people get shook up, you know, when I'm introduced as God, but when you think about it, you know, there is no diminutive form of Godfrey, you see, so it's a natural thing for people to slip into, you see. I mean, I even answer the telephone that way and it shakes people up, you know, I say, hello, God, you know, they start thinking of all their past sins, you know. Of course, I run into difficulty when I'm on the road and I try to send opening night telegrams to all of my actor friends in New York, like, and sign them that way. You know, for example, Leroy Jones, the playwright, just opened a double bill of one-act plays in New York called The Slave and The Toilet. Great titles. So you can just conceive of the situation. I'm down in Washington in this real swank hotel and I'm trying to send an opening night telegram, you know, saying good luck to the cast and company of The Slave and The Toilet. Here's to a long run, signed God. And charge it to my room. I just hear it always, come on, no, you're putting me on, you know. Of course, I have problems like that, because I sent, Brock Peters was doing Othello in Washington, and I sent him a wild opening night telegram. I said, Dale Brock, good luck tonight. You're in good shape if you can just keep your hands off that white lady's throat until 11:30, signed God. And the ultimate, of course, the ultimate was, on a Christmas day, some idiot called me about 8 o'clock in the morning, and I said, hello, God. And he said, is Mary there? Oh. I said, no, she fulfilled her function, and we let her go. Oh, boy. I have biblical thoughts sometimes. And, you know, I was just thinking, you know, sometimes you start thinking about something, and I was running across the Bible, and I read about Lot's wife. You know, I just figured I'm just having to be open there. And I started thinking, you know, we always hear about Lot's wife, so she turned to a pillow of salt. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you never think about poor Lot. I started wondering, you know, like, what kind of guy was Lot, you see? And I could just see Lot, you know, after it happened, running around the neighborhood saying, she never listened. She never paid attention. Sodom and Gomorrah, it wasn't such a bad place. She never listened. And then I can see him transported to 64, you know, after the great event. And he gets on the phone, he goes, he says, hello, Blue Cross. What kind of coverage I got? No, it's not appendicitis, it's my wife. She turned to a pillar of salt. I am not calling from a bar, idiot. Uh-huh, yeah, yeah. Well, what do you think I want to do about it? Yeah, I know, buy a dozen hard-boiled eggs. Oh, boy, you're a good group. Well, it's been that kind of a week for me, you know, like I missed out on another one of those commercials. My agent called me from New York to tell me I didn't get the Tarrington commercial. The black eye didn't show up. Oh, well, what are you going to do? After all, my name is Godfrey Cambridge, I weigh 112 pounds, and if I look fat to you, you're prejudiced. And you know, being around nightclubs a lot, you know, most people think that, you know, you'll booze it up quite a bit, you know, like, ah, I get smashed. But I've sort of laid off the sauce of late because I'm what is known as a bad luck drunk, you know. Two drinks and I'm in trouble, you know, fall down the stairs or something, I break my leg. So that I can remember last New Year's Eve, I got a little swacked, a little bombed out of my mind, you know. And I know that's bad for our image, but I don't give a damn. Yeah, hell with it. Roy Wilkins don't want to drink, that's his business, you know. I like the sauce, you know. I like seeing the kids running around saying, "Ah, oh, look at that drunken colored man." Yeah. And my wife says, "Shut up, it's your father." You're a good group. So I got stoned, you know, and I left the club like that, in my crucifixion pose. So I told the wife, "Look, honey, you drive the car." So we get in the car and we start off, and my wife crosses the green light just as it's turning red, you see, and a cop stopped us up in the middle of the next block. And he said, "Madam, you went through the red light, but I'm not going to give you a ticket, but I feel it's only fair to warn you, it's a dangerous time of year to be very careful, that's how accidents happen." And my wife responded in a very amicable fashion. She said, "I didn't go through no red light." "No, madam, you misunderstand. I'm not going to give you a ticket. You ran through the red light, but I'm just telling you to be careful because that's how accidents happen." And she said, "I did it so fast." I said, "Officer, she went through the red light. I saw her, but she ain't going to do it no more." And she said, "See that? You got to go and open up your big mouth and tell me how to drive, and then you got 15 traffic tickets in the glove compartment you ain't paid for yet." "Hi there, officer." "Make it a racial issue." "You said to me, 'You shut up. You're obviously drunk. Look at your eyes. They're red.'" And I said, "So what? For all you know, I could be a big white rabbit." So I managed to get out of the whole situation, the whole problem. And I exercised my masculine independence, and I got out of the car. You know, I said, "I don't want to drive with you." So I got out, and after I got out, I realized I had no money with me, because I usually carry most of my money in my attaché case. So all I had was a token and a dime, and I was in New York, so I used the token to get on the subway, and now I'm hungover. It's about 6 o'clock in the morning, and my whole head is like boom, 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 boom. The whole African drum chorus is starting. I'm getting ready to put down the whole African continent, right? And I'm trying to sit up there on the bench straight so I don't look bad for the race, you know. You know, somebody come by and say, "See that? Just come up from the South. Don't know how to act." Idiot, he don't know I ain't never been in the South. So I'm sitting there with that throbbing hangover coming on, and finally I find two broken Anacin in the bottom of my overcoat pocket. And I said, "I got to take these Anacin. Now, where can I get something to drink?" And I took my last dime, and I put it in this Coke machine. And the Coke came, but the cup didn't. So I've given up drinking, gang. I'm a bad luck drunk, and forget it, you know. I'll join the WCTU or something.